Greetings from the National Archives. I'm David Ferriero, Archivist of the United States, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this virtual book talk with Elizabeth Mitchell about her new book, Lincoln's Lie. Before we begin, though, I'd like to tell you about two online programs we will be presenting in commemoration of Veterans Day. On Tuesday, November 10th at 3 p.m., retired Commander David F. Winkler will be here to tell us about F. Hayden Williams, a World War II naval officer who played a pivotal role in the creation of the World War II Memorial here in Washington, D.C. Winkler's book is called Tribute to a Generation, Hayden Williams and the Building of the World War II Memorial. And in a special Veterans Day film screening on Thursday, November 12th at 5 p.m., we will show the recently restored version of William Wyler's World War II film, Memphis Belle. Following the screening, NARA Supervisory Motion Picture Preservation Specialist Chris Austin will moderate a discussion with Catherine Wyler, film producer and daughter of William Wyler, and filmmaker Eric Nelson, who collaborated on the restoration and used the outtake footage in his 2018 documentary, The Cold Blue. Since the beginning of our nation, presidents have had uneasy relationships with the press. We remember Abraham Lincoln as a towering figure in American history. It's useful to remind ourselves now and again that Lincoln, like all historical figures, was a man struggling with political hurdles, affairs of state, and daily governance, as well as conducting a war on a national scale. In Lincoln's Lie, Mitchell shows us another side of the 16th president through the lens of an overlooked historical episode. Elizabeth Mitchell has written several nonfiction books covering politics, sports, and history, including her most recent acclaimed saga, Liberty's Torch, The Great Adventure to Build the Statue of Liberty. Her novella-length work, The Fearless Mrs. Goodwin, was a nonfiction bestseller. Formerly the executive editor of George, one of the nation's political magazines, she has worked as an investigative reporter and features writer. Now let's hear from Elizabeth Mitchell. Thank you for joining us today.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth Mitchell, and we're going to talk today about my new book, Lincoln's Lie, and the story and the research behind it. So it's something that happened in 1864 when Abraham Lincoln was in the process of running for re-election. It talks a lot about what goes on with Abraham Lincoln and the press. Now, it's a little bit of a different version of him than we normally are used to, because I think everyone came up with the idea that, you know, Abraham Lincoln was this kind of simple Illinois lawyer who was, you know, just sort of a man of the people who was kind of carried to the presidency. But the reality is that Abraham Lincoln was quite a savvy manipulator of the press. Sometimes to humorous effect, and sometimes just purely to win office or defeat his opponents. We're going to start back, actually, in 1861. Abraham Lincoln was setting off to his inaugural, and he decided that instead of going directly to D.C. from Illinois, he was going to take this circuitous route through the Union and then down through the South to D.C. to meet everyone. So it was a way to sort of get to know the local legislators. It was a way to meet the press along the way, and it was also a way to actually let the people meet him and, you know, see for themselves what kind of man he was. So this was, the kind of older version of a major press event. So the train sets off. It's a very, celebratory event, and all along the way, there are people, big crowds gathered, sometimes acting a little crazy, but in any case, everything is going fine. Now, he has along for the ride a series of a number of journalists, and among those is one Joseph Howard. Now, Joseph Howard was working for the New York Times at that moment. He was a very witty, very stylish reporter who was famous in New York City, seemed to know everyone from Henry Ward Beecher, who was kind of the Billy Graham of his day, to the people in the theater district and all the powerful people within the media. So he's out with Abraham Lincoln on the train ride and writing these incredibly witty reports back to his readers. And those papers, the New York papers, were extremely important, and they would go wide through the country and even overseas. So as they're going along, they get to Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Now, Joseph Howard has sort of retired for the night in his hotel room after they've gone to this dinner, and suddenly an agent of the government comes into his room, slams the door shut, and says that he's not allowed to leave for the rest of the night. Now, Howard didn't take this lightly. He immediately demanded that he get an explanation, and the agent refused to say anything for a while, but finally admitted what had happened was there was a death threat against Abraham Lincoln, and they were having to smuggle the president through the dark of night down through Baltimore and D.C. without having any stops and basically in disguise. So Joseph Howard, not very content with the fact that he couldn't go and report the story himself, is sitting in his hotel room waiting to be released at dawn so that he can go file his story, and he just starts making up things. So one of the big things he made up was that Abraham Lincoln was wearing a costume to go in disguise, and this was a cape and a Scotch cap. Now, the Scotch cap was a little dinky cap on the top of his head, and it was very much the opposite of the stovepipe hat that everyone knew Abraham Lincoln to wear. So he puts that in his article, and it's the New York Times, and everyone trusts the paper. And the next thing you know, every cartoonist in the country picks up that story and runs with it, and makes these ridiculous images of Abraham Lincoln in this disguise, sneaking through the cover of night. And it's made that the president elect is a laughing stock. He's a coward. He's slunk past all of his critics to get to D.C. Now, Lincoln would later say to his bodyguard that he was sorry that he had actually, succumbed to the advice of his, his advisors to get to D.C. in that particular way. That it made him, it caused more division, even as he was going to, try to unite this splintering country. Where, already the Confederates had been declaring their leadership, their new laws. They had even had Congress people, stealing books out of the Library of Congress to bring down to their new library that was going to represent the new country. So it was a kind of nightmare for Abraham Lincoln. So that relationship, though, with Joseph Howard was not dissolved by that particular incident. In fact, he went on to be invited along for various, trips that Lincoln took to talk to generals and into events at the White House. So we get then to May of 1864. Now, this is a re-election year. There's a lot at stake. I mean, first of all, Lincoln at this point is he's weary from the cares of the war. He says in the early part of the year, I don't think I'm going to make it to the end of the war. This is ravaging me. And so he is filled with sorrow over how many people have died in the war and is very fearful that the Union will not be successful. You also have the fact that there's real challengers to Abraham Lincoln for the presidency, and the biggest challenger is the Democrat George McClellan. Now, McClellan was, a darling of the Union side early in the war when he went and won a few he won the first few victories. They weren't huge victories, but they were important in terms of setting the sort of tone of, where the Union was going. But Lincoln became frustrated with him over time. He felt that he wasn't aggressive enough. He was not pushing the forces as hard as he could. And so he eventually fires him. So when we start the story, McClellan has just issued this report that is his report to the government of what he saw during his time in the Civil War. And it's not very good for Lincoln. The other thing is we have a world of extraordinary partisanship. The Democrats and Republicans were basically at each other's throats. there was, you know, all kinds of fury over, you know, who was the better man, how to solve the problem of ending the war, you know, who was the most corrupt, etc. And the thing that was really feeding into that was there was the invention of the telegraph 30 years earlier. And at the time of the book in 1864, the telegraph had now become something that was ubiquitous. It was not just something where you sent, you know, a sober message to your loved one to say, you know, that your aunt died or whatever it was. At this point, it was the kind of thing that if you wanted to change your date from, say, dinner to, you know, going to the opera, you would do it through the telegraph. It was like our internet. It was our email. And Samuel Morse, who invented it, originally thought, you know, the telegraph is going to be incredible. It's going to bind the country together. We will suddenly understand each other so much better. But the problem was that actually, once we understood each other better, we found that we were more divided because people hadn't understood before the differences of opinion across the country, and suddenly they did. And so Samuel Morse was so disturbed by this, he actually started a society that was meant to bring the country back together. The interesting thing there is that his idea of how to bring the country together was that basically everyone who had an interest that they wanted to see through had to just abandon them. So, you know, women shouldn't vote, push for the vote. You know, different religious groups shouldn't have, you know, tried to get anything their way, etc. So his idea was just everyone should be a little bit quieter, I suppose. So, in any case, you had that tension going on, and then you had media. Now, the media at the time was, you know, mainly these three very important men who ran the New York Times, the New York Herald, and the New York Tribune, and they each had a very different personality. Now, the other thing that was going on with the country was there was a financial crisis. It's pretty extraordinary when you go back and look at exactly what was going on in 1864 and what kind of a crisis we were in. For one thing, the greenback, which was essentially the dollar, had in 1860, at the end of 1861, had gotten separated from its value to gold. In the past, after a certain amount of time, you could supposedly take your greenback to the bank and get the equivalent amount in gold. But at the end of that year, the Secretary of the Treasury said, well, actually, we can't reimburse you with the gold, and so it's going to have gold floating as a commodity. So what that did was created this incredible betting opportunity for people who wanted to show to invest in gold at times when the union was doing badly. Because if the union was doing badly, everyone understood that it meant that that paper that they had in their hands would very likely never turn into value again. Whereas if you had gold, gold could be used overseas. It could be used to pay all sorts of you know, taxes and, you know, charges for goods all across the country. So people saw the opportunity in that, and one of the things they were doing was funneling information directly from the front back to DC and then back to Wall Street and putting in these enormous bids. So I have this little booklet, which was very important back then, which shows the path of gold. And you'll see at the bottom of that chart is the 1862 year, and then the next year, the higher, next highest one is the 1863, and then you see 1864 above it. And you can see the extraordinary inflation in the value of gold between those years. And here, too, this person who made this booklet, who was Joseph Howard, but not our Joseph Howard, a different one who appears to have been a jeweler at Tiffany's, but he would track, you know, something. Here's a bit of news where the Union forces were extremely successful. Gold goes down. Here's a moment where a law is passed. Gold goes up. So these trackings were followed by pretty much everyone at that point. People were crazy for the gold market, including just your average person. Like, they talk about priests would be there, and, you know, somebody who ran the tavern, and somebody who was sweeping the streets. They would go and they would either bet in the gold market itself, or they would bet on the street. There were people called curbstone brokers, and they were there all the way into the evening, and sometimes even, you know, well into the evening, taking bets. And sometimes they were also taking bets on things like not just what the value of gold was right then, but would gold change value in the next 3 minutes? And so they would, there was a clock that showed what gold's value was at any given time, and people would just bet each other on the streets. This was causing havoc with the economy of the country. I mean, because first of all, you had the war costing $2.5 million a day. You had most of the men off at the front, and many, you know, families had lost their main breadwinner. You also had this, you know, kind of manipulation that was going on. And so the country, when you look at the documents of what was going on with the treasury, we're seeing drops where they were basically losing half the value of the holdings of the country over just a couple of months. So this was a point of extreme tension. And I have some images that are, I think, kind of extraordinary. One is actually Wall Street in 1864. And I think it's kind of very interesting to see what it looked like at that moment. But the other thing you have is this image that shows the gold market in one doorway, and then the telegraph office right next to it. And that's, you know, indicating how quickly that information was coming from the front, you know, on the wire, run into the gold market. So at that time, too, the war was not going particularly well. There was the Battle of the Wilderness. Now, I think this is kind of a fascinating moment in the history of the war, because they were battling in a situation where they couldn't even see each other through the thickets of the woods. And so they were just trying to basically fight blindly. They would just try to hear each other and then, you know, and then fire. It was causing enormous casualties. There were basically 20,000 some odd people who were casualties in that particular battle. And the reports coming back from the front were so spotty and hard to understand what was going on, and people were just anxious, deeply anxious for the news to know how their loved ones were doing. They felt that Abraham Lincoln was not taking these casualties seriously enough, and there's this cartoon that shows him, you know, asking for something funny, another funny story, because he was known to love a funny story, while all of these bodies are lying around on the field. Now, the other significant player in all this is Mary Todd Lincoln, who was a brilliant woman, I would say. She was also very compassionate. She was going to the hospital wards, and she would go and visit with the soldiers and hold their hands, and she would sometimes, she wrote a letter for someone to send back to their family. And she was appalled by Grant's policies during the war, and she told her husband she thought he was a butcher because he had no plan. He was just throwing people to be killed. And the other thing for Mary Todd Lincoln was she was a very, very insecure person. She felt that because she was from the Midwest, she would never be accepted in Washington, D.C. or New York. And she was somewhat right. I mean, they no matter what she did, she got critiqued, and she was always trying to make up for it by, you know, wearing the latest fashions and going and doing this shopping sprees where she would try to look like the other people in Washington did. And every time she was, you know, she was given a hard time about it, including there's this photo here where she basically is dressed with the wreath of flowers and the low cut dress, and they said she was dressing too young for her age. It was a point of real pain for her, and as a result, she was just shopping constantly. And you know, there was, I had not understood before I did my research the level of luxury that was in New York at that time. I always thought it was sort of, you know, the Ken Burns, everyone's taking this very seriously, the sorrow is throughout the country. But in New York, to a certain extent, there were people who were just ignoring the bloodshed, and they were profiting off the war through the purchasing of gold, and they were buying luxury items from overseas, and there was this kind of, as one writer said, the Vanity Fair was alive in New York City. And I have this image, too, that is the large shopping department store where Mary Todd was spending a lot of her money. It was a place that was importing lots of luxury goods, and it was considered, you know, the absolute pinnacle of elegance and, you know, excitement. And so, you know, I have a picture here of Manhattan, which will give you an idea of, you know, it's as it is now, except for the fact that we don't have our newspaper alley where it was before. But you had City Hall, and then running alongside it was where all the newspapers were collected, essentially. And then just a little bit lower than that was Wall Street, and they would feed off of the news coming into the financial markets. And then you had the harbor, and the harbor was where, you know, information was coming back and forth to Europe. And at the particular moment that we're talking about, May of 1864, there was a ship out in the harbor, and it was the Scotia. Now, it was due to leave at noon that very day, and it was going to take all of the information of what was happening in the war, bring it to Europe. There was a lot of tension right then about what was going to happen if France and England recognized the Confederacy too early. They were very anxious to just basically recognize the two sides and just start business going between the countries. But Abraham Lincoln absolutely, of course, did not want that to happen. And so he, in previous years, had sent Reverend Henry Ward Beecher overseas to actually plead the case. And now Beecher was the most eloquent person on the planet. And so he was able to go and win a little bit more time for Abraham Lincoln. But it was a very dicey situation in terms of whether they were going to you know, go ahead and recognize the two countries. Now, one thing I didn't talk about at the beginning, but I would like to mention it now, is Abraham Lincoln was someone who played with the press. Back when he was a lawyer, he would actually write anonymous letters to the editor about some of his opponents, and that would be, say, an opponent in the courtroom, and then later on, political opponents. There's one incident where he posed as Rebecca in a letter and pretended to be this Rebecca who had come across someone, you know, ripping into one of Abraham Lincoln's political rivals about, it was over the issue of the banking system in Illinois. So Rebecca not only takes apart the guy for his banking positions, but she also basically accuses him of being a philanderer, etc. Now, this was our Abraham Lincoln, our Honest Abe, who did this. And he ultimately was challenged to a duel. Now, because he was the one who got to choose the weapons as the one challenged, he decided he would choose broadswords because he knew he had a very big advantage. He had those big arms. And so when he went to fight this duel on the riverbanks, he started testing his sword in the trees and things, and his opponent saw that he was very easily going to be able to defeat him and called the whole thing off. But it's an interesting moment because basically Abraham Lincoln was able to lie about who he was in this newspaper article, and he never really had to acknowledge it again. It wasn't like a correction was printed. The other incredible thing he did back then was he purchased a German language newspaper in the center of the country with a secret contract. So it was 1860, he's running for election. He knows that the German vote is going to be extremely important in the election. And he buys the newspaper with a contract that says it can't do anything against the Republican platform or he can kill the paper. So this is a pretty extraordinary thing, too, because, you know, we wouldn't have thought of him as the type of person who would do that secret deal. But he was quite determined to make sure that, you know, he had control over the press in that way. So when there's tensions with him and the press, this is not somebody who's a novice to, you know, what's going on. In fact, some of his staff members were writing anonymous letters to the press or anonymous articles about his administration, and everyone would have assumed that this was just, you know, any old reporter who had put it in the paper, but it was actually his people. The other thing was that he perhaps may have even been writing anonymous letter newspaper articles from the White House. There's correspondence between the editor of a Philadelphia paper and one of Lincoln's cabinet members. And the person says, I'm enclosing the president's article in case you didn't see it today, and then attaches this article. And it's not an article that's about the president. It's basically has his view, and it seems as if it's quite possible that he actually wrote it himself. What he has going up against him in New York are these very powerful men who run the New York Times, the New York Herald, and the New York Tribune. And they each kind of represent different demographics. I mean, some of this may even sound familiar to you. One of the papers is violently against the president and is kind of considered like of the people, and you know, and some accuse it of even being of the mob, you know, that it's the mob's voice or something. The other one, the New York Times, has this reputation of having, you know, influence both in Europe and in New York. And there's, you know, the editor of that paper, Henry Raymond, was a huge supporter of Lincoln by this time. He, in fact, was working on this major book about him, and it was only slowed down because somebody had published Abraham Lincoln's jokes just before this, so he had to wait to publish his so it didn't crowd the market. And then the other one was a paper that was very much an abolitionist paper, and in fact, more strongly that way than Abraham Lincoln himself. They were constantly saying, you know, it's time for you to take a stronger stand about slavery. So what would happen is the newspapers would go out and the newsboys would flood them through the streets of New York, and then they would go off on trains, you know, across the country, and they would go on the boat, the Scotia in this case, going overseas to spread the information of what was going on in the United States at this wartime. The one other thing that I want to talk about before we get to the actual incident of that starts the book is there had been the draft riots of 1863. What happened was Abraham Lincoln had been conducting the war with just volunteers, but in 1863 he realized that he actually needed to draft men because he was running low on forces. So when the draft went through in New York, it sparked one of the worst incidents, I would say, in our history. Basically, the white people of the city rose up and just started to pillage the entire city. They were, you know, burning buildings. They were, uprooting trees and shrubs and everything else. They were going around and beating up everyone they could find, and they were lynching black people throughout the city, including mutilating the bodies as well. It was one of the most grotesque orgies of violence. It was 5 days, and eventually they had to call troops back from the front to put it down because the police weren't able to control these crowds. So there was a lot of fear about what would happen if another draft came up. I mean, clearly no one was going to want to, would put up with this kind of violence again, but no one knew what was going to happen. Like, what would it erupt again? And if so, would it be even more fierce? You have to imagine all of those tensions are around at that particular moment. And now we get to May 18, 1864. So at 3 in the morning, there's a young 17-year-old boy who's running through the streets of the newspaper area. It's dark, obviously, and he's going from newspaper office to newspaper office with these fluttering pages of the Associated Press paper with something on it. So as he goes and tries the different doors, some of the newspapers are essentially closed up for the night and can't take any new documents. But in some, although the editors are gone, there are actually people still running the presses. Now, they're under orders to not take anything new after a certain point. But if it's a proclamation directly from the president, then they are to take it. So at two newspapers, he gets in, he gives them this proclamation, and they hesitate for a moment, but then they realize, we have to run this. So they immediately put all their other plates aside and start putting this into lead type and getting it ready to run in the newspapers for the next day. And so the morning hits, and suddenly there is this proclamation in the newspaper from Abraham Lincoln saying, the war is going very badly. The deaths that we have seen are worse than we could have imagined. I want the whole country to pray and repent and ask for some kind of forgiveness, because for some reason we have been chosen as the sufferers of this century. And from this moment, I need 400,000 new volunteers. And if I don't get them, we're going to have a draft immediately. Now, this caused an uproar. People started crowding into the streets. They were gathering on corners. They were gathering around the news bulletin boards to talk about this. And the stock market went crazy right at the beginning. Gold shot up first thing. There was a wild roar of traffic at the stock brokerage. People talk about the fact that it sounded like, you know, some kind of gladiator fight. And then there is this ship out at the harbor that's about to take this news over to Europe. So the first thing that happens is they start to wire desperately from New York down to D.C. to say, you know, is this actually true? Because one thing that started to make them wonder is not every newspaper carried the story. And then they said, if it's true, you know, what are our next directions, you know, in terms of sort of the general who's overseeing New York was wondering, do I need to get ready for, you know, a kind of emergency situation here? And it's taking a while for information to come back from D.C. And finally, they get word that Abraham Lincoln has gone into the biggest rage that apparently one of the witnesses had ever seen him in his entire presidency. And he immediately puts out an order that the generals are to go out and arrest all the telegraph officers, that not just in New York, but also Baltimore, all through Pennsylvania, in D.C., to seize all of the telegrams that are coming from D.C. to New York, and to go into the newspaper offices and arrest the newspaper editors who put in the proclamation and take over the newspaper offices with the military. Now, this caused a total panic within the city, because this was absolutely unconstitutional. There was no warrant for the arrest. There was no going to trial, you know, bringing this to a judge to have them sign the warrant. It was just an immediate seizure, and people thought that Abraham Lincoln was a tyrant to do this. And so as, you know, all of these editors of these important, you know, these two important papers, which were the New York World and the Journal of Commerce, they are fearful that they are headed to Fort Lafayette, which is this prison that was just off the shore down at the tip of the bay of New York. And it was a place where basically people got thrown and the key was thrown away. I mean, there was very little progress in terms of bringing any of these people to trial. They would just sit there, indefinitely. And it was the kind of place that, you know, rats ran rampant. They said that there were tadpoles in the water. There were so many men sleeping in the same places that they were actually sometimes sleeping on a crate overnight. And this was going to be the fate of, you know, some of the more illustrious newsmen of the city. And so people started to wonder, who was behind this? You know, was it a spy who wanted to put this in the newspaper in order to cause problems for the Union and perhaps make the Europeans recognize the two countries was this George McClellan, the Democrat challenger, who was trying to make Lincoln look terrible and therefore get ahead in the race for the presidency, which would be decided in the fall. But the Republican convention was coming up very soon, and there was a question, would Abraham Lincoln even be the Republican nominee? Or people wondered, was it Abraham Lincoln himself? Because he went and immediately arrested these newspaper editors, and the newspaper editor's position was, we just did what we had to do. If we had not put this in the paper, we would have looked as if we were conspiring to, you know, stop what Abraham Lincoln had to say to the people. And so people wondered, was he doing it just to shut down the Democratic papers right at the time when they were needed to be out there as a voice, calling him to task for various problems. Now, the interesting thing is that by the end of the day, after this kind of, wild reaction, suddenly word starts going around that actually in D.C. there was a call for troops. It wasn't 400,000, but it was 300,000. And that was sort of a murmur that went through. But now, because of our access to, the Library of Congress and the National Archives, we are able to go back and look in the archives. And in fact, Abraham Lincoln, on that exact same date, hand wrote an order for 300,000 soldiers, but he put it in his, and he signed it, but he put it in his desk. So the question is, was the reason for his extreme reaction, his fury, not that there had been a fake story, but that there had been a leak from the White House, and he was wondering who had done it, who was so intimate to him that would they would actually do this. And one of the indications that he thought it was a leak is that his first action was to shut down the telegraph between D.C. and New York, which suggested he knew that it was coming, that the information was real enough in D.C. that it could have been something that traveled up to New York. So the story, I don't want to give away too much because it is actually quite a mystery. And when I was doing the research, I was sort of amazed at the twists and turns that it takes. And so I don't want to take away from that if you're considering following the story further. But I think that there's a couple of things to keep in mind, which is that our friend Joseph Howard comes up again. And every time he comes up, it's not exactly, sometimes he looks to be the culprit, and then you realize that it's not quite what you thought. And so I find it a very kind of fascinating story in terms of taking us through all of the people who were trying to profit off the war, the media power centers at the time, and also into the intimate life of the White House. I would be very happy to take anyone's questions about this story, and particularly too, if people end up reading the book, I would love to continue a conversation. And you can reach out to me on Twitter at Biz Mitchell, or on Instagram at Elizabeth Mitchell Author, or on my Facebook page, which is Elizabeth Mitchell, and it's my author page. But I would, because it's the kind of thing where, people, what kept occurring to me as I was doing this work is that essentially history is a mystery, and we will always be coming across new pieces of evidence that are going to lead us to a new understanding of what actually happened in America and what it means to us today. There's a lot of lessons to learn about how to handle fake news, the fact that we need heroes to be cropping up at all times in all different walks of life. For example, in certain instances, it was the lawyers that came through, or the reporters, or just civilians who actually stepped up and questioned Lincoln's acts during this particular event. And so I think there was something reassuring in doing this research to realize, number one, we are not the most troubled time in terms of relationships between the press and the president. And also, you know, we have some techniques on how to go forward to always ensure that the Constitution is upheld. So thank you very much for having me.